Good morning, precious saints of God, brothers and sisters in Christ, members and friends of the Convent Avenue Baptist Church. I'm Pastor Jesse Williams, senior pastor here at Convent in Harlem, New York. Today's a special day in the life of our church family. It is Senior Saints Appreciation Day. So we're taking a pause today and spending some time to just love on our elders, our senior citizens in the life of this church and the community. So join us in this worship experience. It's going to be a blessing. Take care.
Good morning, Convent Church family and friends. Our call to worship this morning is Psalm 100. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he that hath made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving, and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him and bless his name. For the Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting, and his truth endureth to all generations.
Cheers! Good morning. Let us now pray our invocation. O Lord, our Lord, how excellent is thy name in all the earth. Almighty God, we approach your throne of grace with hearts of thanksgiving. Lord God, we praise you and honor you because of your unconditional love towards us. We thank you for your covering, O God, and for providing all that we need, even in these uncertain times. Today, O God, we lift up our senior saints. We honor them for their sacrifice, their wisdom, for their courage and service to this branch of Zion and to the community at large. Lord God, we pray that our Holy Spirit, your Holy Spirit, would abide with us during this worship experience. And what is done here today will bring honor and glory to your name. And Lord, now we pray the prayer that you taught your disciples by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us not our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
This morning's scripture is taken from Psalm 90, verses 1 through 12. That's Psalms 90, verses 1 through 12. Lord, thou hast been our dwelling place in all generations, before the mountains were brought forth, or ever thou hadst formed the earth and the world, even ever from everlasting to everlasting, thou art God. Thou turnest man to destruction, and sayest, Return, ye children of men. For 1,000 years in thy sight are but as yesterday, when it is past, and as a watch in the night. Thou carriest them away as with a flood. They are as asleep. In the morning they are like grass which groweth up. In the morning it flourisheth, and groweth up. In the evening it is cut down and withereth. For we are consumed by thine anger, and by thy wrath are we troubled. Thou hast set our iniquities before thee, our secret sins in the light of thy countenance. For all our days are passed away in thy wrath. We spend our years as a tale that is told. The days of our years are 80 years and 10, and if by reason of strength, they be 80 years. Yet it is their strength, labor, and sorrow, for it is soon cut off, and we fly away. Who knoweth the power of thine anger? Even according to thy fear, so is thy wrath. So teach us to number our days, that we may apply our hearts unto wisdom.
Measured to Jesus. was lost, and right now my treasures are in the sky. I'm glad I counted the cost. My treasures are in the sky. I'm glad I counted the cost.
Good morning, my dear senior saints. Would you have thought just a year ago we would be sitting here remotely in our sanctuary celebrating our Senior Saints Day? As we live our lives as seniors, caring for our family, friends, neighbor, pets, and other saints, would you have thought we would be and a deadly worldwide pandemic? In the United States, we have lost over 2,000 people to COVID-19. Some of us know the loss of friends and family. And yet, at this time, not only are we facing the danger of virus, we are faced with the 45th president and all of his cynicism as we struggle to live our Christian lives. And add to that, we are now in another very critical period, voting. Over the years, senior citizens have led African American to the ballot box. We have held voting as a very special responsibility because many died fighting for this privilege for us. And yet, this is a time when we feel injustice all around us. People are losing their jobs left and right. Some are being evicted. Schools are closing. Small business owners are losing their business. And every day, we grow more fearful of leadership. Yes, with all of this swirling around us, as the kids say, we must keep it real and admit we are uncertain and a little scared, because we are not sure of what's going on in the world. I think it's very honest to be real with your feelings when you are limited in your understanding of it all. But my dear saints, at this time, let us cherish Psalms 27:1. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Whom shall I be afraid? Every day, remember, God has opened doors and made provision for our well-being throughout Scripture. Over the years, as I have grown older and diligently studied God's word, I came upon something that I think seniors can use right now to move forward in our lives with the leading of the Holy Spirit. Stop and think about it now. Our Creator has opened doors of technology, made it available to us so that we can improve our daily lives through technology. We can do it. We need to do it. We must do it. We must appreciate God's gift. Technology and all of his gifts are available to us. Let's not fear it. With our hand and heart led by the Lord, let us learn to use it for our own well-being. I did it. You can do it too. I took classes especially for senior citizen. I learned how to pay my bills online. I learned how to use Facebook. I learned how to communicate with today's youth, with my grandkids, with my nieces and nephew, by texting on my smartphone. When I want to talk to them, you know they mostly talk by texting. Learning comes with a cost. First, we must invest in the technology. It comes with a set of instructions on how to use it. First of all, don't let it overwhelm you. Slowly, you can do this. In the comfort of your own home, you can master technology. Let us not be ashamed of not knowing how to use the gift of technology. Remember, faith will push you past the unknown. Let us grow new levels of faith, for thou art my hope, O Lord God. Thou art my trust from my youth. Psalm 71:5. Ask the Lord how to move forward and be still and hear his answer. Make new learning to do more learning for yourself. As we have taught our children, make new learning fun. Be free to laugh at yourself and with others as you move forward in the use of technology. Let's hold unto God's hand and be joyful while we learn new things. The good Lord have made it possible for us to do this. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. And each day, seniors, live life like it's golden. Happy Senior Saints Day.
Good morning, Convent Avenue Baptist Church family and friends. It's Pastor Jesse Williams here with a few observations for us as we move forward into this worship experience. I want to continue to ask you to please utilize personal protective equipment, even though we're in the midst of a time where it seems like the numbers might be getting better. They are still of importance to us. So please continue to wear a mask that covers both your nose and your mouth. Please also continue to exercise social distancing And please wash your hands and sanitize your hands. It's important for us to continue to do our part. I also want to share with you that on Monday, the 19th of October, our food pantry will be opened and serving the people of the community. So those of you who know of someone or may need to come yourself, the food pantry ministry will be opening and sharing, and we want to make that available to all who are in this community who might be in need of assistance. Lastly, I do just want to continue to share with you the importance of voting. Voting is so very important. Make sure that you have a plan for how you're going to vote. You know where you're going to vote, when you're going to vote, who's going to go with you to vote, because it's so important that we make our voices heard. Today is Senior Saints Day, and we're celebrating the fact that our seniors have paved the way for us in so many different ways as we have grown as a people and as a church family. And one of the things that our elders have done for us is they paid the price so that we could vote freely. They protested, they marched for the right. It is so very, very important. And so we're honoring our seniors and our elders today, and one of the best ways we can honor them is by voting and exercising this very important right. So please make sure that you have made preparation to vote and make your voice heard. That's all for now. May God bless you and may He keep you. God bless you, brothers and sisters in Christ. We've now come to this moment in our worship experience where we're going to worship God in our giving. This is an intentional part of worship because we know that every good and perfect gift that we have comes from the Lord above. And so we worship Him by giving the tithe and the offering. Here at the Convent Avenue Baptist Church, you can give your tithe and offering at least five different ways. Number one, you can give using the mobile application GiveLify. And when you go into that app, look for the picture of our sanctuary. Secondly, you can give using PayPal. Third, you can give using Cash App. And our identity on Cash App is $ConventNYC for those of you who give that way. Or you can go to the church's website, conventchurch.org, and create your own giving profile and give that way. Or you can simply mail your tithes and offerings into the church at 420 West 145th Street, New York, New York, 10031. That's for members as well as non-members of the church. You can give to support this ministry as well. But however you give, give it out of a heart of thanksgiving, knowing that God is the source of your blessings and that you're giving back to God out of that which God has given to you. God bless you. Let us pray and ask God's blessing over the offering. Eternal God, Lord, we do thank you and we praise you for this day. We thank you for this opportunity to gather in this space. And we pray, O God, now that as we prepare to give our tithes and offerings, whether they are mailed in or electronically, by whatever means, that you would bless them and consecrate them. Consecrate every gift and every giver so that your kingdom can go forth here on earth. We ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you. Good morning, Convent. Happy Senior Saints Day. It's a joy to be here in the house of the Lord just one more time. I want to thank my Heavenly Father who chose me in eternity past to be his adopted son. I thank Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, who died in my place and saved me and forgave me from all my sins. I thank him that he's not through with me yet. I'm grateful for the Holy Spirit who applies salvation to my life day by day, shaping me into the image of his wondrous Son. I want to thank my pastor, Reverend Dr. Jesse T. Williams, Jr., who is doing a marvelous job leading our church in this terrible pandemic and giving me the opportunity to stand in this sacred desk and to preach God's word one more time. I want to thank you, my church family, who blesses me each and every day. I want to give a special thanks to my rib, my answer to prayer, Karen, my helpmeet. Thank you for making me a better man. Now, if you have your Bibles, I want you to turn to the gospel according to Matthew. That's the gospel according to Matthew. And we're going to be looking at chapter 11, verses 28 through 30. That's Matthew chapter 11, verses 28 through 30. And this morning I'll be reading from the New International Version, and it reads as such. Come unto me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. And just for the few moments that we're connecting together on this Senior Saints Day, I'd like to speak from the subject of rest for the weary. That's rest for the weary. Would you please pray with me and for me as we go before the throne? And gracious Father, we want to thank you. We want to praise you, Father God, that, Lord, that on this Senior Saints Day, Lord, we're here to rejoice and to celebrate what you've done in your marvelous saints' lives. Thank you, Father God, for your amazing grace and your mercies. Now, Lord, I ask that you would sustain me and keep me, hide me behind the cross, and Lord, let Jesus be exalted. It's in Christ Jesus' name we do pray, amen. I like to talk about rest for the weary. Good morning, Convent. This is the day that the Lord has made, and I'm gonna rejoice in it, even in the midst of a pandemic. I'm gonna praise him, even in the midst of political rhetoric and chaos. I came here to praise the Lord. Just as his word says, though the fig tree does not bud, and there are no grapes on the vines, though the olive crop fails, and the fields produce no food, though there are no sheep in the pen, and no cattle in the stalls, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will be joyful in God my Savior. I am especially rejoicing this morning on this Senior Saint Celebration Day. Seniors are those who bring and have done so much for the kingdom. Now, Back in the day, we did not call our senior saints seniors. You see, back in our day, we used to call them seasoned saints. Now, you all know that I like to eat every once in a while. And one of my favorite seasonings that I like to use, we just call it Tony's. Tony's Chicories, you know, it's original Creole seasoning. And even when my cooking does not measure up, you just throw a dash of Tony's on it, and bam, there's life back into my cooking. Tony's can cover up a lot of stuff just with a little dab on it. And you know, seasoned saints are just the same way. Because every once in a while, things are not right in the church, but a seasoned saint shows up and starts to praise the Lord for how good he's been, and his mercy endures forever, and bam, there's life once again in the church. Thank you, Lord, for our seasoned saints day. As I get older, every year, I find that I don't have as much energy as I used to. Yes, in fact, if I was to really be honest, I'd say every once in a while, I get tired. I get tired of people. I get tired of situations. I get tired of suffering. Sometimes it's easy just to be sick and tired of being sick and tired. I'm tired of racism. I'm tired of white supremacy. I even get tired of politics. I'm tired of liberals pushing and normalizing perverted behavior on the nation. I'm tired of conservatives favoring the haves over the have-nots and not caring about the needs of those who are vulnerable. I'm tired of social distancing. I'm tired of not having face-to-face fellowship and worship in the house of God. Could I make a confession this morning, Convent? Can you keep a secret? You promise not to tell? Sometimes I even get tired of me. Yes, I get tired of me because I know what a wretch of a person I am. And sometimes I get tired of dealing with me. Is there anybody else out there that every once in a while, when you lay your head on the bed, you think the same thing, that I'm just tired and worn out? This is a message for those who know that they're tired, those who know that they are weary and that they are burdened. That's who Jesus gives this invitation to. And those like John the Baptist, who was disappointed that God didn't do what he thought that he should do, and he was in prison for doing God's will. Like the religious people whose expectations was not being met by Jesus, who was claiming to be the long and promised Messiah. They thought that Jesus would bring the kingdom in immediately, but he said, "Thy kingdom come and thy will be done." It's not yet. This invitation is given for those who were tired of being oppressed and treated as less than by the Roman government. The amazing thing is that Jesus gives this same timeless invitation to us who are gathered here under the sound of my voice. Come to me, all who are weary and burdened. And you know what? I like that because he doesn't give any other qualifications. He says, if you are weary and you are burdened, come. If you're willing to humble yourself and admit that you need rest, this invitation is for you. Whether you have a PhD or a GED, if you are weary and burdened, come to Jesus and he will give you rest. The invitation is not for the mighty or for the famous or for those who are confident in themselves, but only those who are weary and burdened. You may be wearied and burdened by work. You may be wearied and burdened because of lack of work. You may be wearied by sickness, by depression, by pain, by disappointments. You may be weary of oppression. You may be wearied of being excluded, not being in the in crowd. And some of us are even wearied and tired of having to deal with our biggest enemy, who is not the person who sits on Pennsylvania Avenue, but our biggest enemy sometimes is we ourselves, and we're tired. I stopped by this morning to let someone know that Jesus can and Jesus will give you some rest. Rest in a real and tangible way. Rest for our souls. The soul is the very center of our life. The soul is what makes us unique. It's what makes us us. Body, soul, and spirit. Jesus promises rest not to the body, which outwardly is wasting away, but inwardly is being renewed, but that inner us that is more precious than we can even imagine, our souls. We never think about our souls that much until we're between a rock and a hard place, or we think that our time has run out, but Jesus is addressing an issue that maybe the weariness and the burdenness of that we're dealing with is not just an aching muscle that you can take an aspirin or a Tylenol for. Maybe Jesus is getting to the heart of the issue that our souls are tired and burdened, and the only one who can give us rest where we really need it is Jesus. Jesus is the one who said, what does it profit a man to gain the whole world, yet lose his own soul? God knows that our souls need rest. We try to entertain, pacify, and distract our souls, but nothing can satisfy that longing for rest and peace that only being connected to the Savior can give. Jesus will never force his rest and peace on anyone, but each person must decide for themselves that they will pull themselves away from the distractions that life can bring and to come to the source, the only source of rest, peace, and joy, and that's Jesus alone when he says, come to me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, all you that are weary and burdened. So what happens when the weary and the burdened decide to come to Jesus? Well, when we decide that we're going to pull away from everything else that has been grabbing for our attention, when we decide that as soon as the service is over, we're going to pull away from Facebook, we're going to shut down Twitter, we're not going to look at our email, we're going to turn the TV off, and we're going to go to the Lord who can give rest to our soul. What happens when we do? We find that we have immediate acceptance. Jesus had just been saying, I thank you, Father, that you've hidden these things from the wise and understanding, and you have revealed them to babes. Such was thy good pleasure. Jesus, who's the Son of God, and he's God the Son, creator, sustainer, savior, mediator of a better covenant, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and judge on Judgment Day, invites and he accepts anyone who's wearied and burdened. No preconditioned. He doesn't say, clean yourself up first. He doesn't say, yo, I want you to start and clean up your life first. No, he just says, if you're weary and you're burdened, come. And when you come, he accepts you. It's an open invitation. It begins when we give our life to the Lord, but it doesn't end there. Jesus provides peace and rest for our soul on a moment-by-moment basis until we see him face-to-face, when we will enjoy peace forever. Jesus invites the least and the last of us to come into his presence and to get rest for our souls. He accepts us just the way that we are. We don't have to be like anyone else. Whoever is humble enough to come and say, I need rest that only Jesus can give to my soul. Am I talking to anyone this morning? Jesus, who knows everything about us, invites us to come. He knows those areas that we have tried and we can't change. He knows that we can't buy rest, we can't manufacture rest. This rest has to be given to us, and only one person can, and that's Jesus. It's his rest that changes us from the inside out. I don't know about you this morning, but I'm glad I don't have to be the most popular person in the room. I don't even have to be like anybody else, because Jesus accepts me just as I am, and then he works his love and rest into my life. I'm thankful that he accepts me just as I am, but I'm more grateful that he doesn't leave me like I am, but he transforms me into his glory. I recall the account of a man and his wife was walking through an airport, and they were changing flights, and they had to walk from one terminal to another. The husband got on the moving sidewalk, but his wife decided that she would just walk down the highway the whole way without assistance. So the husband is walking down the moving sidewalk with ease because he's walking under the power of someone else. In other words, he was moving, but he was resting as he was going along in his journey. His wife was walking in her own human effort, her own ability. With less effort, the husband covered more distance in a lot less time. Now, the husband was feeling really proud about himself, so he's getting to the end of the journey, and he figures, well, he's gonna gloat over his wife. And so he turns around to see where she's at, and he doesn't see her. And he goes, where are you? And all of a sudden he hears her voice calling out, but it's calling out from in front of him. And the husband said, how did you get ahead of me when I was walking under somebody else's power and you were struggling in your own effort? She says, I realized I could never make it in my own strength. So I saw one of those carts and I hitched a ride on it. And I understand that if I was going to get to my destination, I needed some help. And that's what Jesus is saying, that if we're going to make it through this pandemic, if we're going to make it through our difficult situations, we're going to need to rest that can only come by the grace of God. Amazing grace. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Grace is what he offers at the foot of the cross. Every once in a while, some of us, we've been serving the Lord for so long, we think it's up to us. We've been doing ministry for so long, we think it's up to us. But it's really the grace of God that accepts us just as we are. And it's the grace of God that will take us where he wants us to go. Grace, grace, God's grace. Grace that is greater than all my sins. Grace, amazing grace. Grace that he gives us the moment we decide that I'm going to come to the only source of rest. And when we get there, we'll find out that he knows our name and he accepts us. So what else happens when the weary and the burdened decide to come to Jesus? Yes, we do get immediate acceptance because of his grace, but we also find that we get intimacy in an abiding relationship. Jesus says, take my yoke upon you and learn from me. Jesus applies an agricultural metaphor to symbolize intimate relationship and discipleship. Jesus says to place his yoke upon you. Not the world's yoke, not sin's yoke, not other people's yoke, because you can never please people. Jesus says, take only his yoke upon you. Don't put the deacon's board yoke on you. Don't put the church's yoke on you. Put Jesus's yoke upon you. In other words, Jesus is saying, put him first in your life. Love Jesus first in your life. Now, the yoke in agricultural setting normally held two oxen together while they plowed the ground. Usually you had one that was more experienced and strong on one side and a younger ox on the other side of the yoke. the experienced one will pull harder and guide the younger one. And Jesus says, put him first in an intimate relationship. And when you do, he will reveal his heart to you. He says, learn from me. I believe that one of the tragedies in this pandemic is the education of our children. Instead of the benefit of having in-person instruction, they must look to a small tablet if they have a fast internet service. I have always believed that the teacher makes the difference. A good teacher can make a difficult subject enjoyable, even bearable. Jesus himself is the master teacher. He knows how to teach and reach the unteachable. I know because he reached and he teaches me. He knows how to reach down right where we live, in our hurts, disappointments, in our struggles and weariness and burden by his Holy Spirit, and helps us move from weariness to rest, to move from burden down to joy. And his name is Jesus. Somebody ought to praise him right now. Yes, no one can give us rest like the Lord Jesus when you're in an intimate relationship with him. He, even though he's Alpha and Omega, the first and the last, even though he's King of Kings and Lord of Lords, he wants an intimate relationship with you. Intimate is not based on your title, not based on what you've done or not done. He wants to know you, and he wants you to know him. Now, if you want an intimate relationship with Jesus, what that means is that you can't hide things from Jesus. In other words, we put on one face on the outside, you know, and want everybody to know us like that. But see, the Lord knows everything that we're going through. And he wants us to be honest with him and say, Lord, I'm hurting. Lord, I'm lonely in this pandemic. Lord, I don't know how I'm going to make it. And you open your heart to him, and then you can learn from him. If we want to have an intimate, abiding discipleship relationship with the Lord, then we can't keep holding on to things that the Lord wants us to give up. Yes, through an intimate relationship with Jesus, putting him first, saying, Lord, I love you, I'm putting you first, he transforms us from the inside out. He changes us into his likeness. He must increase so that we will decrease. Yes, I'm glad on this Senior Saints Day, I know that there's rest when we come to Jesus. And when we come to him, we find out that we have immediate acceptance. We have intimacy and abiding relationship. But thirdly and finally, we find that we'll have indwelling faith in his loving heart. Jesus says this, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. That's an amazing statement. So many times when we look at those who are in places of leadership, What they're known for is maybe their leadership style of being aggressive or forceful or decisive. They're known for the principles that they use. But Jesus, who is the best leader of all, said, "My sheep hear my voice and they follow me." One of the reasons that I believe that his children will always follow him is because of his heart. This is one of the few places in all of Scripture that the King of Kings actually reveals his heart. Yes, Jesus has the very attributes of God: omnipresence, omnipotence, omniscience, etc., etc. But his heart, under it all, is gentle and humble. And you know what I found? It's easy to trust someone when they are humble and when they are gentle. Even though he is the Messiah, the ruler of the universe, he will not quench a dimly burning wick. Even though he's all powerful, he carries the lambs in his arms. When things are going rough and you want to throw in the towel, will you trust his heart even when you can't see his face? Let me say that again. Will you trust Christ's heart even when you can't see him at work in your life? Because when you come to Jesus, you get immediate acceptance. You get an intimate, abiding relationship. You have indwelling faith in his loving heart. Yes, his yoke is easy and his burden is light. Life is tough, but having indwelling faith in his love and heart for you makes the toughest things in life a little bit more bearable. When I read this paragraph, I asked myself, how can Jesus say that his burden is easy and his yoke is light? Because anybody that's lived for more than a minute, especially if you are a seasoned saint, you know that serving Christ is anything but easy, and life is anything but easy. And then as I was thinking, I thought, you know what, I have a confession to make. I have a confession to make before everybody this morning. There is one thing in life that I hate doing more than anything else. There's one chore that I absolutely cannot stand to do. And you know what it is? You might have even guessed it. I hate doing laundry. Oh, I've always hated it. I don't know why I hate doing laundry so much. I know it has to be done. But why me, Lord? I've never liked doing laundry, even when I was a youngster. And you know what happened to me 5 years and 5 months ago? I got married. And you know what? I don't know why, but my wife has a lot of clothes. And guess who sometimes gets to do the laundry? Moi, I get to do it. And as I'm doing it, I asked, what changed in my life? Do I love to do laundry? No, I still hate it as much as I always did. Well, why do I jump at a chance to do it? It's because I love my wife, and I want my wife to be surprised when she comes home and finds that everything is already done. You see, love is always the issue with the yoke that you put on. You see, when you put on people's yoke, it's always going to be a burden. But when you put on the yoke of love, you will always be motivated to do whatever love requires. And that's what Jesus is saying. He says that when you take his loving yoke upon you, it will change you and help you to endure some things that you never thought that you could, because finally you understand that God knows you and God loves you. Yes, God's love is what's responsible for changing us. Yes, God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whosoever believeth on him might not perish, but have everlasting life. Yes, he loves us, and when we connect with him, we find that we were able to do even the things that we never thought that we could, even have rest in the midst of a weary situation. I thank God that there's rest for the weary. Yes, there's rest because he accepts you just the way you are. Yes, you'll find rest in an intimate, abiding relationship that's called discipleship. Yes, you'll find rest because you will have his yoke of love in your life. Let's give the Lord some praise, because there's rest for the weary. Amen.
Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. We thank God for the Word of God, which has been preached to us by our minister of evangelism, the Reverend Booker T. Morgan, on this day. I'm thankful that I was able to hear that there is rest for the weary. Now, having heard a word like that, some of you who are watching today may need to have a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, or you may need a church family. And I want you to know that even though we're in this virtual platform, both of those are available to you. If you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. So if you don't know Jesus Christ for yourself, you can get to know him right now. Or maybe you're already a Christian, but what you need is a church family to be connected to. Either way, whether you're accepting Christ or in need of a church family, you can connect with us here at the Convent Avenue Baptist Church. Contact us via our Facebook page. Contact us via our website. Let us know that you want to connect with this ministry, and indeed, we will welcome you with open arms and open hearts. May God bless you, and may he continue to keep you in his care. We look forward to hearing from you. God bless you.
Let us pray. Why should I be discouraged when Jesus is our fortress? We thank you, God, for being a God that never changes and never fails. We thank you for being the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. We thank you for your tender mercies that are new every day. And we thank you today especially for our seniors who have seen the newness of your mercies day after day after day. We thank you for keeping them and allowing them to testify that great is our God and worthy is he to be praised. We come as you have instructed, asking you to be our refuge. We come thanking you for what you have done, what you will do, and what you are doing right now in this very moment. We ask that you would bless our church, our family, from the head of the deacon board to the very children that we minister to day in and day out. We ask, God, that your Holy Spirit would reign fresh in the lives of your people. We have so many uncertainties in these days, God. We don't know who we can depend on, Lord. But we are so, so fortunate that we can come and lay our burdens at your feet and that you will listen and that you will answer. We pray that you would fill our hearts with joy, for so many linger in sadness, Lord. You did not give us a spirit of fear, and yet somehow we have found one. But we know, God, that you can tear down all strongholds that serve to hurt and destroy us. So we pray, O God, that those who are walking in fear, that you would wrap your arms in love and protection around them, God, and give them the confidence that you are still with us. As you said to Joshua, as you were with Moses, you will be with us. Thank you, God. Thank you for letting us have a peaceful night's rest. For those who are struggling with insomnia, for those who are struggling with mental health, God, we pray that you would touch them with a finger of love and healing, God. For those, God, who are facing surgery and procedures, God, we pray, oh God, that you would touch them with a finger of love and healing. God, we pray that you would come and destroy any plans that the enemy has placed before us, God. We pray, oh God, that not only will you destroy them, but what the enemy meant for evil, you will use for good. Walk with us, God. Talk with us, God. And continue to show us that your way is the best way, God. And that if you go before us, who can come against us? We are your children, God. We bow before you because we have confidence that no weapon formed against us shall prosper. So, Lord, for those who are living in a situation of domestic violence, God, for those who are dealing with breast cancer, God, we pray for a healing from you, God. We pray for deliverance for anything that is in the way of us doing the things that you would have us to do. Sweet Holy Spirit, have your way in our lives. Remind us, God, that you're still in charge, that you're still in control, and that God is still on the throne. We thank you in the name of Jesus. We give you all the glory and the honor you so richly deserve. In the name of Jesus, we do pray. Amen.
And now, brothers and sisters, let us receive our benediction and closing. And now may grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit rest, rule, and abide with each of you, both now, henceforth, and forevermore. Let all of God's people say together, Amen. Well, brothers and sisters, what an awesome worship experience we've had. Thankful for the word of God that came to us from Reverend Morgan on today. What a blessing it is. A special shout out to all of our senior citizens, senior saints, elders in our midst. We love you. We appreciate you. We thank God for you. May God continue to protect and preserve you during these days and times and in the days to come. Until the next time, God bless you, and may He keep you in His care. See you next time.